One of the last issues, I think, which I want to flag is this whole issue of environmental flow, I think, which is coming up very critically nowadays in terms of things, both from, you know, because with less flows and type of thing, the pollution and other type of things are becoming serious. Rivers cannot function or continue to perform its own natural environmental services and other things, and also there is an issue of downstream people's needs and things. So here I would again say that, no, if you have to conceptualize it differently, one is the whole question of principle of subsidiarity. Subsidiarity would mean that if a lower unit, hydrologically lower unit, can meet your needs, then water should not be brought in from a higher order. Now, for example, in a micro watershed or a watershed development context, we can say that if the water needs, in terms of basic needs like drinking water, domestic water, and agriculture needs and things, can be met from a small micro watershed, then probably water should not be brought into that watershed from a you know, like transfers across sub-basins or basins and that type of thing. This not argue that there are not situations where this some amount of transfers may have to be required because of the unequal distribution of rainfall, people's livelihood patterns and other type of things. So we are not saying that no transfer should take place. But we should have a certain methodology to work it out how this should be done. Environmental flows cannot be considered as a residual thing, like you allocate water for all other needs. If there is something left over, the way it's being done today, then you do it, but you need to factor that in. And you can also go by this average numbers that 15% of the flows should be this one. There should be, each system is different. We need to study it and see for different seasons how we can work out the flows and things. And only the remaining water need to be allocated. In fact, there is also a debate saying that the debate should be the other way around. We should talk about minimum extractions from the river so that we can meet our needs with the lesser water footprint, so that more and more water can be kept unbound in the river system. You also may be taking a little a different viewpoint about highly regulated rivers where dams and things have come up in a large manner, then probably there we may have to take a different approach than non-regulated rivers where too many dams have not come up and systems are much in its fresh condition. Then you can have a differential thing where you can build in there. For example, one of the experiments or exercise we did in Kerala was that there's a Chalakudi river which is highly regulated, about 6 to 7 projects there. So they looked at how a different hydropower operation system can also improve water in the downstream and things, and they have been able to negotiate that with the political system and they were able to do it and things. So probably we need to take a little more creative approach, saying that it's not saying that no dams should be in the thing because we don't work with a clean slate anymore. Most of the rivers are actually dams and things. In the US, for example, people are talking about decommissioning dams as one of the options and things. So that could be one option, but I don't know whether how socio-politically it is accepted or acceptable in our country. But otherwise, there are also other things which we can do. You know, dam reservoir operations, if you do it differently, then it can improve water availability in the downstream as well as environmental flows and things. Cumulative impact assessments are coming up in a big manner. This has been talked about in the northeastern context much more because in each of the rivers there are, you know, more than, whole lot of projects are coming up. So instead of environment impact assessment, I mean, there are issues related to the way environment impact assessments are being done. And I don't think the country, any single project has been, you know, rejected on the basis of, you know, EIAs, and think there are a whole lot of issues related to that. But even within that, unless you look at the whole carrying capacity of the river as a system, or the cumulative impact of the different projects are coming up in totality, then probably may not capture the entire impact of the interventions we make and things. Issues of water quality is also an important thing. It's not the question, as I said, how much each user uses. With each use, there are certain return flows which is coming back into the system. If you use, let's say, 100 liters for our domestic, this one, for example, we may be consuming 40 liters and 60 liters are coming back into the system. So the whole sewage treatment, recycling becomes an important thing, and this is much more critical in the industrial use. Industries do say that we only use 3 to 5% of your water, but the damage it creates is much more, because so in what form this water comes back into the ecosystems is a very critical issue. And I don't think in any river basin we have any study to say that what is the type of partitioning of the different source of pollution, whether in terms of habitat or human, basically we would call lack of treatment and recycling, industrial pollution, and even what you call non-point pollution like agrochemicals which is coming into the system. We have no assessment at all. So I think one of the important things which we need to demand or which we need to say is that unless some rough level estimations of where do these pollutions come, so that we can also think of what type of solutions we can do. So unfortunately, they don't exist today. groundwater mining and its related issues. I think there is some session on groundwater itself, so I would not get into that. Another critical issue, which I think is one of the last issues, is what do we say about waterfront industries? I think this is also a very polarized debate. In the mainstream, more and more water is getting allocated to industries, many places, and things. So are we saying that no water to industries, or how do we say? Because at least some of us believe that agriculture per se cannot sustain everybody's the growing livelihood needs or the aspirations which I talked about. And this, so there may be some form of industries and things. Then what form of industries, what type of industries is going to create, and things, an important question. So allocated industries should not be at the expense of existing livelihoods. I think that's one of the, again, as an overarching principle. I'm not saying that it should be applied as a template, as Vishwanathan says, but what I'm saying that when we are concerned about allocation, even if certain amount of water is reallocated to this industry from agriculture, then it should not be at the expense of those people whose livelihoods are dependent on that water. So we should be able to create avenues in terms of either efficiency measures or various other type of things we can create that, for example, more production with less water efficiency and other type of things, and one way of out of this allocation issue. Second issue is nature of industry, like its size, ownership structure, products, pollution impact, extent of reuse, recycling, etc., should also come into the decision making when you make a allocation issue and things, what type of industry we are promoting and things. And also, again, how do you incentivize things like recycling, for example? I think part of the water for the industry's need need not be always come from the fresh water. There are all other water can be made available through various options like recycling, reuse, local water harvesting, and various other types of things. And only after those options are actually over, then probably you should make a claim for a water from an external source and things. I mean, this also goes for cities. I mean, cities today, there are no limit. And I don't think there is any social movement in any city today saying that we don't water from, let's say, Kaveri or Krishna or other type of sources. Everybody is happy. In fact, there is other way around. If there is some cut, then people agitate. Even they don't mind cutting water for agriculture and things. And today, in the policy regime, because domestic water has a higher order priority, everything gets justified also. Limitless water diversion to cities and type of things. So I think the cities also should be able to develop certain norms saying that what is the type of local assessment, local assessment of the local rainfall, local water harvesting, groundwater availability, recycling, reuse. And only that then, only then probably then they can make it. I mean, unless you build this into some of the financing of the projects and things, or build into conditionalities and things, I don't think any city will move to a different regime of things. I would also argue, I mean, this also contested, I'm not saying that this, I'm putting it as my fully, thought about this. One of the things which I've been thinking about is that unless industries also invest into water-saving technologies, for example, especially in the agriculture, if we say that agriculture accounts for, let's say, 80 to 85% of the water use, even a 5% saving in that is a large water quantity. Now, why can't industries then invest into this so that, you also create some type of positive, some game type of an atmosphere in which then they can claim for, let's say, at the most, the saved water to some extent so that, other people's livelihoods are not affected. This is one way of looking at it. Yeah. Yeah.
So I think you should be careful.
I'm careful, yeah.
Okay. Water is a local resource. Yeah. You can save water somewhere and use
take it from.
So the very good example of this is Pepsi produces that water. I don't know what it's called. Their bottled water.
Bottled water.
So it is. If you look at the bottle, every bottle is titled water positive.
Water positive. Yeah.
They have very big, global claim. I said they are water positive in India, and about 80% of their water positive part.
Yeah.
They actually extract more water and
play,
recharge everything. Comes from, they have some work going on in Punjab where they have tried some low water use rice varieties and all this, they have funded in some manner. And then that water forms the bulk of their water positive. Whereas they don't have any factories there, the factories are all over other places. So this kind of a
So I also, I'm not saying that I'm fully agreeing or something, but I thought this one way of, I don't know how you bring in caveats and things. So, also there are some industries are talking about socially responsible water use. I think that's also important to take note of. I mean, I'm not saying that industries, there may be a few cases where even within the industries also there is some sensitivity which is developing. So how do you bring all that into a larger discourse is an important thing. At least I think in the service industry, I think there is little more sensitivity in terms of the type of appliances they use, the water use efficiency, recycling and type of thing. But I think there are larger questions about what happens with mining and larger industries, thermal power plants, for example, all these are very important questions. I think you are also switched with some experiments in Bangalore and places and things. So I grant what Sripad said that, yeah, there are this downside of this argument. So that's what I said. I also
careful,
yeah. Yeah. I mean, yeah, that's true. As a license for, yeah. The last thing is institutional restructuring which is taking place. I think we need to note that after the 90s, there is some type of a changing role of the state. I mean, 2012 water policy is a classic example of that, where it is clearly mentioned that it is not the responsibility of the state to deliver water anymore. You can have different arrangements. They have talked about water use associations or PANI. I mean, or the Gram Panchayat is taking over some of the, in a way, decentralized managing. Or they have talked about other companies or private entities managing water and type of thing. But they clearly state that, you know, state is not supposed to deliver water, whether in terms of irrigation or in terms of drinking water and things. And state role is only to regulate. I mean, this is one of the changes which is, I think, increasingly have been taking place in 2012. Water policy has actually crystallized this to a great extent. You also find a lot of space which is created for communities and participatory institutions. I'm not saying that things have been moving only in one direction. And I'm not saying that is all this, you know, but imposed by World Bank and other type of thing and this, but I think we need to creatively find out ways of engaging with that. Now, for example, various studies have shown that water use associations have by and large failed. I mean, many studies have implicated, whether it is Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra, or many places. But we also find like watershed development, very interesting examples where people have come together and actually gone beyond what is the type of legal provisions which have been done. Now, there are cases in Maharashtra I've seen where participatory management mechanism has been utilized to bring in much more integrated use of local and exogenous water and groundwater and surface water. People have used this type of institution building to say that even private wells can be charged by the water use association to pay. So there are cases of that type also doing. Or in South Maharashtra, we have seen that even landless people becoming members of water use association, though the law provides that only the legally entitled people can become entities. So there have been cases, which may be very few, which have found that we can creatively utilize some of these spaces which is created. So instead of saying that these are all World Bank created institutions and things, we need to creatively engage with this, what they're coming up. So this is one space which is opening up in terms of things. But these institutions are much more driven by efficiency considerations, equity, sustainability, democratization type of normative concerns actually do not come into some of these in the mainstream institutions which have been created. And the regulatory bodies. I think this is a very important thing coming in the water sector. Maharashtra was the lead. I mean, 2005 onwards, you have a regulatory authority which is there, which has been crafting various types of things like how does water entitlements play out, on what basis should be done. I think it will be dealt with a little later in the equity and water right discourse and things. Pricing and even giving powers for sanctioning projects and type of thing. So it is a very overarching thing which earlier the functions which thought the political system should do, today is being handed over to something what they call a professional body, thinking that professional bodies can be much more efficient in things. I mean, same thing which will be electricity or basic other type of service sectors, there are regulatory bodies coming up. Now, one of the arguments why regulatory body coming up is saying that there are going to be private players. That is one argument saying that why do we have regulatory bodies? There are going to be multiple players and there could be private players, so there is somebody to regulate that. Second argument is that state cannot do all the three functions, like, you know, political decision making, allocation, execution, and monitoring and regulation type of thing. So you need something like an outside the executive body to do these type of regulatory functions and things. So one of the, I mean, Maharashtra, many people, Prayas and other people have been doing a lot of work on the regulatory bodies. There's that MUNCH which I talked about also. I've been engaging with the Maharashtra Regulatory Authority in a big manner. So one of the things which I would suggest is that some of the issues like allocation, pricing principle, which is much more political in nature, should be allowed or should be actually operate within the political system of the, you know, the governance. And some of the other issues like monitoring, regulating, once those principles are agreed upon, can be handed over to a regulatory body. So unless we disaggregate these functions, probably then everything we are handing over to a set of professional bodies. That is the larger debate. Second, the way it is being operated I mean, it is the same bureaucrat sitting in the regulatory authority today. I mean, Maharashtra example is a classic case where there is no independence. I mean, supposed to be, these are supposed to be independent regulatory bodies. So right from the practical levels to even much more philosophical levels, there are issues the way the regulatory bodies are coming to the water sector today. The Maharashtra model is being copied by different states and things, so it has something. So I think this is one thing which we need to work with and things. And it also calls for a different set of skills and knowledge base. Earlier, movements used to demand certain things to the state. It could be in the nature of much more political demands and other things. But today, if you have to engage with some of these regulatory bodies, you need different skills because these are quasi-judicial bodies. There are set processes. Now, how do you democratize at least? The way this functioning can be done is also a serious issue which we need to consider. So, institutional restructuring the water sector is, I think, is an important issue which has been coming up right from the 90s.